Ó, a noite livra maior cara. Please, you here. Thank you for accepting my invitation. And tonight, think about it. Nick is training. Ele é treinado na área da desse química.
Hello, my name is
Can you hear me?
Nicholas. Yeah, I can hear you now.
Yeah, we are. We okay.
Sorry, some
So
connection
I
issues.
was saying that, I was saying good evening. Yeah, I was saying good evening, and that we could start the show, but it's always happened, technical issues. I don't know why, but sometimes it doesn't work well. But anyways, so I want to thank you for being here, for accept my invitation. And
Of course.
we're going to talk a little bit about chemical dependency, how you treat it, a little bit about behavioral mental health, how we treating people here in America. You already know it. They still say that we are back, that we backstage.
Sorry, what was that?
Let's see. Right?
Sorry, I didn't hear that. The
They
video cut
say that
off and I
we
couldn't
are
hear.
backstage, but you cutting off? Yeah,
Sorry,
there's
say that again?
many technical. Every time we try to do this, it is like it's
Hmm.
having. Go ahead.
No, sorry, there's a
You know,
delay in the audio.
oh, what a, yeah, it is. It's kind of hard. You try. I was trying to see that we can talk a little bit.
Yeah, talk about substance use, mental health.
Yeah, I don't know what happened. We were talking, and then suddenly it just go dark. I was just saying that it is good for you. You can give a little bit of your experience. Talk a bit. All your training that you have been done on chemical dependency, on the treatment of people who has the chemical dependency history, so that it's it, so as we talk. I will try to talk a little bit in Portuguese that everyone can understand
Course.
that
Yeah.
what we are talking about. Okay. So, primeiro I'm going to say a little bit in Portuguese. Boa noite, Brazil. Good evening, American. É um prazer estar aqui mais uma vez no Observatório Brasileiro de Direitos Humanos e agradeço por este espaço, né, ao Dr. Marcelo Henrique e todos os seus colegas. É, hoje aqui temos o Nicolas Renamont, ele é especializado no tratamento de dependência química e também na área de saúde mental. Então, ele é mais apaixonado pela área de tratamento, né, da pessoa com dependência química. Nicolas tem muita experiência nessa área e acabou de fazer um treinamento intenso, né? Dependência química. Então, Nicolas e eu sempre estamos falando sobre o assunto e eu convidei ele para vir aqui e falar um pouco da experiência dele, de como ajudar e contribuir, e por isso ele está aqui. Good evening, Nicolas.
Good
I
evening.
would say, I would say it's a pleasure to have you here. I appreciate you take the time. And so, as I was saying, you already know a little bit about the story that, you know, in Brazil is a little bit different. Especially now that it's chaotic, you know, it's very unstable. Society is very unstable with many problems, with many social issues, a lot of violence, especially the vulnerable population right now is one that has suffered the most, you know,
Of course, yeah.
especially people with behavioral mental health, people with history of substance misuse. You know, women and the most marginalized, the vulnerable, the poor, the black, the poor, and the indigenous people. Então, so it is. It's been very difficult. It's very been stressful for the population, for the people of Brazil, because they right now, it's like there's no escape. It's like you have to face what is going on, you know, politically, and the public health system is really not helping the way it should be treating the people with behavioral mental health or do diagnosis, as we say here, right? So you know a little bit the story that we spoke about it before, you know, how people are treated. Just today I was reading in the news from Brazil, in Portuguese, of course, that they were saying that in São Paulo, they just passed a law that they will force people to do people who has a history of of drug misuse, they will force them into institutions so they can get clean. They actually pass a law. So as we know here, it's a free will. Here people have the option, you know.
Though it hasn't always been that way. I mean, historically in America, we had our phase where we used prisons and mental health hospitals as places to lock up people with substance use issues, and very little actual treatment happened. And we had to grow through the peer movement, through you know, changes of legislation in protests to get people to actually have recovery and not just locking people up because we don't accept them for, you know, things that they struggle
for who
with.
They are or for this. But that's the problem right now in Brazil. I see, because I know the history as you do. I see that Brazil is going the same route that people here went all the way back. You know, they are locking people up. They said that people with mental health history, people with do diagnosis are dangerous people. They should be locked up. But the problem is that inside this institution, people are getting kidnapped, people are being kidnapped, people are being raped, people are being tortured, people are being sexually abused inside of this institution. They are being killed, tortured. And in America, we know that a lot of things happen, but I never heard of such horrible things, the things that is happening in Brazil. And I don't remember reading like things like
that. No, not that bad. Yeah.
That bad, you know?
Yeah.
That I haven't heard that before.
Yeah.
So, and from your perspective, from what we have read, what you have wrote and added my work, you know, I will talk a little bit in Portuguese and to explain to you. So, eu estava explicando a Nicolas, porque ele conhece toda a história já, muitos casos do Brasil, ele tem lido as coisas que eu tenho escrito e publicado. Então, ele estava falando, né, como sabemos, aqui também nos Estados Unidos teve uma época, né, na época de 70, que também teve muito problemas com as pessoas com saúde, de saúde mental, pessoas que tinham problema com dependência química, que eles também eram forçados a se tratarem. Né? Mas isso mudou, porque chegou um ponto que as pessoas disseram, não, eu não quero ser tratado assim. Né? Eu tenho direitos, e esses direitos devem ser respeitados. E também, a outra forma é que esse tratamento forçado não funciona. Não funciona, a pessoa tem que querer ficar bom, e isso tem que ter todo um processo, não só pegar a pessoa e dizer, eu vou te tratar, pega, joga dentro de uma instituição. Não funciona dessa forma. Né? Pessoas que sofrem de deficiência de saúde mental e dependência química, eles precisam de compreensão, é um processo longo, lento e demorado. E para isso as pessoas têm que ter treinamento na área. Então tem que ter um tratamento humanizado, não brutalizado, como está tendo. Tem que ser um tratamento humanizado, não brutalizado. Não adianta fazer leis, passar leis e forçar as pessoas dentro de instituições para se tratarem, que não funciona dessa forma. Né? Eu sei que a intenção é boa, mas não é assim que funciona. Falando de um ponto de vista de que eu trabalho na área da saúde mental, nos um maiores hospitais de Nova York, e Nicolas também trabalha. Então, tem que existir uma outra forma de... As leis podem ajudar, mas não dessa forma. Tem que existir um tratamento humanizado, um processo em que as pessoas... vai aceitando a sua condição para poder fazer esse tratamento. Enfim. Nick, I was saying that it has to be humanized, you know, the way the process it was done here. Because if you don't humanize it, you just force people into an institution, it won't work. Go ahead.
I was just going to say, I think where change really has to come from is from the people on the ground level. To kind of paraphrase a quote in reference to World War II, the greatest evils of the world are caused when good people do nothing. And unfortunately, it's a lot easier now, I'm guessing from the stories I've read, for people to say, well, that's not my problem, or, you know, those people probably deserved it, they were bad people, because we can tell because they have substance use or mental health problems. But, I mean, it's a very different story when it's someone you love, or if you're the next person that ends up happening to.
É, como o Nicolas estava dizendo que... Tem as pessoas quando, you know, se você tem um problema de saúde, de problema de dependência química ou de saúde, de transtornos mentais, a pessoa fala, não é na minha família, não é meu problema. Mas quando você vê o problema na sua família, aí você começa a se doer, começa a dizer, não, é meu problema também, não, vamos fazer alguma coisa para mudar. Então, aí é que se torna, se todos nós fizermos um pouco, uma parte, podemos mudar essa o que está acontecendo agora. Porque o dependente químico e o deficiente, eles precisam de ajuda, mas de pessoas que possam ver longe, de pessoas que possam entender a sua situação, precisam de compreensão. Não há necessidade de brutalização, não há necessidade de espancamento, não há necessidade de torturar a pessoa até a morte. Então, como o Nicolas disse, as pessoas têm que querer se tratar, mas têm que começar dos profissionais, né? Os profissionais como enfermeiros, como pessoas que está, como assistente social, que entende mais, né, da condição humana, o que é o sentimento humano, né? Yes, Nicholas, I was saying, you know, that you were saying that you were saying that, you know, that the ground level, né? Like in Brazil, you usually is a social, is a social worker, is a psychologist, other people who they don't have the system that we have here. They don't have the peer work. I thought my dream was like, if we could have something like that as a peer, you know, or just, I don't know, that's a dream. Go there and train and have like get a grant and go there and train it, like a chunk of people that this is the way that we do in America. Is it possible that we can train some? Do you think it is possible, like from your perspective, you with all the training that you have done in the Exponent, do you think it is possible that we can train like a group of people down there, or we can do like a online classes that we can start educating people about it?
Absolutely. In fact, one thing I would hope could come out of this is not just that, because I don't think it would necessarily work to just say, hey, let's do it like we do in America. I think
That's
that
true.
Brazil needs to find its own way to do it. But I mean, it's just like, there have been some problems with spreading democracy around the world, even though there's with noble intentions. But ideally, what should happen is don't just copy us. Find a better way that works for your society, for your people, because people in Brazil are going to have different values, different things that are
Yes.
important to them, and different things that are going to motivate them to help people that are not going to be the same as what we have here. So we can at least have like some people demonstrate this is what we do, but also let's find something that like let's help you. Like when we work with participants, we try not to do things for them. We try to
Yes.
help them do it for themselves, to empower them and to advocate for themselves and for the things that they care about. Because we don't want to just have everyone modeling the way we do it, because that's just not going to work out as well. Better to find something that's a perfect fit and that grows naturally for the people in Brazil.
So what you say is that, you know, we can design a course like a model and teach the same way that we work here with the participant, you know, and like empower them, but the final decision and the final steps that they are the ones who has to take it, right?
Absolutely. I mean, certainly as someone in America, I do need don't need to be talking about like colonializing and in a way that's sort of been happening with ideas in the past century or so that we tried to spread our values to everyone else. And I think that that's caused a lot of problems. And instead, what we should do is, like what we do with the peer model is let's help people, let's help the people in Brazil that care about this find what's a good model for them that works best. And then they can, then maybe they'll even be able to teach us because our system is by no means perfect. We still have a long way to go to get to a fair, just system for everyone. But yeah, we are doing a little bit better now, but that could easily change with the change in politics, the change in funding, the change in training standards. So it's something we always have to keep in mind to keep a healthy and growing in the right direction.
But one thing that we know for sure that human rights violation, it will not be as bad as severe as in Brazil right now
Sure, of course.
against the vulnerable population. That we are sure things can change, but it will not get that bad the way it is now there, right? So Nicolas está dizendo que, né, nessa área de tratamento de dependência química, né? Nós não vamos dizer, ah, esse aqui pode servir para você, você faz isso. Não, ele está falando que a gente pode, né, organizar, elaborar uma aula e mostrando como nós fazemos, né, como nós ajudamos as pessoas aqui com dependência química, como ajudamos as pessoas com deficiência, que sofrem de deficiência de saúde mental. Podemos mostrar um modelo, né? Podemos treinar e mostrar, mas aí a palavra final será a da população brasileira, o que funciona melhor para eles, eles quem tem que tomar a decisão, o que é melhor. Podemos mostrar, tentar ajudar, como as coisas, como nós temos tratado das pessoas aqui, né? Num sistema humanizado, né? Com a pessoa com dependência química, pessoas com problemas de saúde mental, podemos mostrar um modelo, um exemplo de como fazemos aqui. E a última decisão seria das pessoas que, depois que vê, eles tomam a decisão, eles podem implementar e fazer o que melhor funciona para eles e para as pessoas que querem fazer o tratamento ou para as pessoas que querem trabalhar com essa população. Mas uma coisa que ele falou, as coisas estão sempre mudando, né? Nós não podemos dizer que não, porque tá exatamente neste momento agora as coisas estão mudando muito rápido, né? É no mundo todo, com a pandemia, então comportamento muda. Mas uma coisa que eu estava falando com ele é o seguinte, as coisas podem mudar nos Estados Unidos, mas violações de direitos humanos aqui não é tão ruim como é no Brasil. As violações de direitos humanos no Brasil são assustadoras. E isso é em nível nacional. Começando do estado do Maranhão até o Rio Grande do Norte, São Paulo, as violações de direitos humanos são muito assustadoras. O ser humano é tratado sem respeito, sem dignidade. E se você é negro, de classe menos favorecida e sofre de deficiência de saúde mental, você é tratado como um bicho. Ou é tratado como um usuário de droga, como aconteceu com José Vandeilson Vavá, né? Como disseram, ele é um drogado. E sumiram com ele faz 11 meses e até hoje ninguém sabe nada. E tá todos os envolvidos estão muito calados. Como é que existe? Isso são violações de direitos humanos. Isso aqui não acontece nos Estados Unidos, porque se acontecer, na mesma hora, a polícia bate na porta, o FBI bate na porta, e aí tem que dar conta onde botaram o rapaz. I'm sorry, Nick. I was explaining about all the violation of human rights and how that got into the young man, the 17 years old young man, Vavá. And I would say that if that happened here with a person who has a history of behavioral mental health, a minor, that if that had happened here, by this time, the police would already known where he was, who did it, who did it not. And in Brazil, it is now 11 months and nobody's talking, nobody say anything.
Yeah.
So Nick, do you want to talk? Can you talk a little bit about, you know, your experience, like the way that you feel that how you would like to help, knowing the situation that, like you already said, that we can tell people what to do, we can show them, we can empower them, we can show, oh, this is the way we do, that's the way we have been helping people, and you know, you want to share with you. So tell a little bit more, how would you take this approach?
Sure. Well, I think one of the most important things to do is, I think, and this is an issue globally that we all have to work on, but in some for some populations, it's more difficult than others. But I think it's seeing everyone with their innate humanity, regardless of a background, of the color of their skin, where they come from, what language they speak, what religion they follow, how able or disabled they may be, anything, you know, I think so much fear is driving the way we treat people these days. And I think having compassion and concern for others and wanting to support them and having that shifting that mindset that, that these aren't people that are breaking laws, that are morally bad, or need to be punished or should be shamed and ostracized from society. These are people worthy of compassion and support, and they can contribute to society and help in a lot of different ways. Even if it's also, if it's helping other people with their, with similar kind of backgrounds that have had certain kind of struggles. I've met so many people. I have personal experience being someone who was on disability, wasn't working for over 10 years, struggled with drinking and substance use and needed support with that. And I'm at the point right now where I'm working full time. I'm about to, you know, I just finished my training to become a substance use counselor. And I'm about to start, you know, working on my hours, get the full credentialing. You know, I'm helping. I've, you know, I feel like that's what's been driving me is helping other people. And, you know, I've gone from a point where, you know, someone could have seen me as a drain on society where I'm just getting tax dollars or, you know, just not really contributing at all to now being a pillar of support for a lot of people. And, you know, even just talking right now and trying to share some of my experience and maybe how that can help people that aren't even part of my local community, but part of a global community. And this is coming from someone who's diagnosed with bipolar disorder, who struggled with alcohol, you know, who's I know one of the populations we haven't mentioned is the LGBT population, which I'm a member of. I'm bisexual. And there's plenty of discrimination going on there that there, I would hope there'll be more acceptance for people regardless of who they choose to love. But yeah, it's a lot of work, but I think more important than improving the mind, I think it's opening the heart and getting people to see others with compassion and hope that, that they can be more than what they're struggling with right now.
Yeah, I think you're right. I think it's the lack of compassion.
Mm-hmm.
You know, is
sorry, everyone, having some technical issues. And I'll be on in just a moment.
Different sexual orientation, they can be a huge contributor to society, right? But the way you say it, we do this in America. So I'm gonna tell a little bit, try to do it, to stay a little bit in Portuguese, so that people can understand, you know, where you come from, how you know. So Nicolas and I estamos conversando e ele está falando que o que também, né, pessoas com que têm deficiência, seja ela qual for, ou seja qual for a sua raça, a sua cor, e a sua orientação sexual, o que está faltando, né, em todos nós é compaixão, né, é compaixão pelo próximo, é humanidade, é entender a dor do outro, né? E ele está dizendo que todas essas pessoas, eles podem contribuir com a sociedade. Eles podem ser grandes contribuidores para a sociedade. Eles podem passar a pagar táxi, eu não lembro como se diz, impostos. Né? Eles podem ser passar a pessoa a trabalhar de alguma forma, a ser parte da sociedade. Porque o que está acontecendo... Ele mesmo falou que também tem problema de saúde. Ele tem problemas de saúde, mas ele é bipolar. Né? Ele é bipolar, é bissexual. Mas ele, em algum ponto da vida, ele também teve problemas com álcool. E ele... saiu dessa, ele teve todo um apoio, né, dos profissionais da área de saúde. Ele começou a trabalhar, depois começou a trabalhar integralmente. Antes trabalhava só metade do dia, 20 horas por semana, depois começou a trabalhar 40 horas por semana. Agora ele já vai receber a licença dele para trabalhar na área, para trabalhar ajudando pessoas com história de dependência química. Então, ele é um exemplo. Ele é um exemplo. Tem inspirado, né, as pessoas com quem ele trabalha, como ele fala que nós temos diferentes valores nos Estados Unidos, e o Brasil tem diferentes valores, é uma outra cultura, mas uma coisa que todos nós temos é humanidade e compaixão, isso é universal. Compaixão e humanidade é uma coisa que é internacional. Nick, Nick, I was translating what I was just saying. What you say, you know, compassion. Mm-hmm. Compassion is important in this field. You know, compassion for the people you work with, and understand where they come from. You know, and how do you feel? How do you feel that the way you work, that you're gonna get a credential? What are the things that you imagine that you want to do once you start work as a substance misuse counselor?
Well, the work I want to do, I don't know. I think the secret or the root of where substance use counseling is right now is in it's not so much about treating the substance use as it is about giving people a better alternative, a better life. And then naturally, a lot of the times, the substance use kind of goes away, or at least gets much, much better. We've also moved away from a abstinence only, like you just stop using as being the focus of treatment, and shifted instead into harm reduction, which is about, okay, so right now you use because you need something to help you get through the difficulties of life. But with harm reduction, it's not just stopping the substance, because a lot of times people can't just stop using if you don't give them something to do instead, because people tend to use because it helps deal with stress. Mm-hmm. It helps deal with emotional dysregulation or problems with dealing with emotions. And instead, we encourage people to find as healthy a life as possible now. And then maybe they'll be able to let go of the substance use and live a healthier life. And mental health is actually very, very similar. It's not so much, we've moved away from a disease model where we just talk about the negative, trying to get rid of the negative aspects of life, and instead encourage people to find employment, to work towards goals, to build relationships, be part of the community, to connect with others. And by doing that, it also encourages people to be more motivated, be an active part of their recovery and not just relying on doctors or therapists to do work for them. Instead, empower them to find their own solutions, because those also tend to stick a lot longer than just writing someone a prescription or, you know, telling them to just stop something. You have to give them something else that is a value of to them, because it keeps them motivated to try to improve themselves and to also to find a life that they actually enjoy living. And I think that benefits all of society, because I think the collective misery that people experience helps sort of encourage a lot of the oppression we see around others. It encourages violence and, even human rights violations, I think, are rooted in a lot of people having very unhealthy attitudes or being dissatisfied with their life and looking for someone to blame, looking for someone that can be responsible for the things they're unhappy with in the world. And again, we're having technical issues, so.
We're back. Sorry about that.
Yeah, no problem.
I don't know what happened. I don't know. Sometimes the connection is I don't know what. So you were saying that when I asked you about the you know, as a future counseling, you work with people with substance misuse. I myself, I have a little bit experience when I was for the DOHMH that I would go on the street, and I remember that I would ask people, you know, so. Would you like to, you know, it was freezing cold, and I would ask, so would you like, you know, to have a hot meal, a bed to sleep tonight, you know, that doing that and give the person a choice, I think that's also the most important thing.
Yeah. And what I was sort of saying before, I was just sort of talking about before, the way that we're doing treatment for people is very different in the past 10 years than it really ever has been. And this is both true for mental health and substance use. For substance use, it's moving more towards harm reduction, which is saying, let's see if you can still use, but use in a safer way or maybe with safer substances. And then let's work on improving your life, giving you a life you want to live to keep you motivated and also give you tools to cope with the things which are the reasons why you're using substances in the first place. And then as that also relates to mental health, it's not just about treating the negative symptoms that one's experiencing, but also giving people helping them find a better life for themselves. And then they can also contribute to society. They can pay taxes, they can work, they can build families, and they can also advocate for other people. And, you know, these are also people who vote. Apologies again for the technical issues.
Hey, Nick. Yeah, I'm gonna try. I have tried this in the computer. See me now? Can you hear me now better? I'm trying the other computer.
Okay.
Is it better now?
Oh, yeah, I think so, a little bit.
Can you see me now?
I see an image, okay. But the video doesn't seem to be moving, but I hear you.
So we were,
that's
we
what's
were
important.
Saying that. We will say that. Go ahead.
So I was just talking about how with treatment that we're looking more so than focusing on the substances or the mental health. It's trying to give people a better, or helping them find a better life for themselves. And, encouraging them to be active in their own recovery and not just rely on professionals to do it for them. Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, much better.
But if you don't, you're given the option, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the problem is that right now what's happened there in South America, you are not given that option.
I know, no.
You are forced to it. And it seems there is not a lot of information. There's not a lot of like awareness that we have a lot of awareness here, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I thought when we were speaking about it, that it should have awareness first before you have experienced, like we were saying, you know, I have been there. And I left myself up. I had the support. I had the help, and I made it.
Mm-hmm.
But like you said before, it's a different system.
Yeah.
And we have different values.
Mm-hmm.
But that it doesn't mean that the same model that we apply here, the best practice, it doesn't mean that it would not work there.
Sure.
Right?
Yeah, I think unfortunately Brazil is probably going to have to go through it's a little similar to what America did with, or the United States did, where for one thing, laws need to be changed. People need to go out. People need to protest. People need to change the minds of politicians and stop seeing people as people with these issues as being those that need to be locked up, and instead be those that need medical attention. They need help. They need support. And it's not just wasting money, or it's not punishing bad people. It's helping people that can do great things in society and make things better. If you look at a lot of the famous people in history, you can find mental health diagnoses and substance use all over the place. Some of the
Einstein.
Greatest minds.
I can tell you about Einstein.
Sure,
Van
absolutely.
Gogh.
Look at any of the political leaders. Tons of them had mental health and or substance use. In American history, Grant, one of the greatest generals of the Civil War, was a raging alcoholic. And Lincoln, the president at the time, was incredibly depressed and dealt with anxiety issues. And these are like pillars of our culture. And yet so many people, you could find everyone has some trace of either some substance use type behavior and or mental health traits. Absolutely everyone. It's normal. Some people have it worse than others, and those people need support, but it doesn't mean that they need to be tortured. It doesn't mean they need to be killed. It doesn't mean that their families need to be lied to, their bodies stolen. Like that's just straight up human rights violation. Like these are people that deserve human dignity.
It's like, yeah, sometimes you have to smile, because if you cry, you won't stop.
Yeah.
You know? Nicholas está falando que na história dos Estados Unidos tem pessoas que se for você for olhar a história como ela realmente é, tem pessoas muito famosas, parte de nossa história, que tem problemas de deficiência de saúde mental, tem problemas com álcool, né? Como o presidente Lincoln, ele tinha depressão. O Van Gogh, um dos maiores pintores, né? Einstein também. Então, Nicolas está dizendo aqui que as leis do país também têm que mudar, têm que tratar mais humanamente as pessoas. Então,
que a população tem que sair nas ruas e protestar, também ajudar a educar os políticos do país, que essas são pessoas, são seres humanos com problemas, né? Que eles não são criminosos, que eles não são pessoas... Você não pode criminalizar um deficiente mental, a pessoa que sofre de deficiência de saúde mental, de transtornos mentais. Você não pode criminalizar uma pessoa que tem um problema de dependência química, porque também é um problema de saúde. Então, que as pessoas comecem a se organizar, a se movimentar, a educar e a mudar os pensamentos dos políticos, das pessoas que têm o poder nas mãos, porque isso acontece com qualquer pessoa. Deficiência, saúde, problema de saúde mental e dependência química pode acontecer com qualquer pessoa. Não é porque não vamos apontar o dedo, não vamos dizer porque aquela pessoa tem dependência química, ela é uma pessoa ruim. Não. Você não sabe da dor e do sofrimento daquela pessoa. Então, vem aquela história da humanização, da compaixão pelo outro, pelo ser humano. Então, para que as pessoas sejam tratadas humanamente, com respeito e dignidade, né, tem que existir uma conscientização em massa. Tem que existir uma conscientização em massa no país. Tem que existir uma forma de educar as pessoas que deficiente químico e pessoas portadoras de deficiência, seja ela qual for, não é razão, motivo para serem vítimas de abusos, de atrocidades, né? Que esses são cidadãos deste país, são cidadãos brasileiros que merecem ter o seu respeito e a sua dignidade. E o Estado está totalmente fora de controle, porque o Estado não está protegendo a população frágil. So, e o Nicolas estava falando que por nós termos esses valores aqui, que a dignidade humana é respeitada, a dignidade dele como ser humano é respeitado, ele se tratou de dependência química. Ele é uma pessoa reformada. Ele tem bipolar. Ele trabalha integralmente. E eu tenho muito orgulho dele, porque ele trabalha junto comigo. Nós trabalhamos num dos maiores hospitais psiquiátrico, não consigo dizer a palavra em português, psiquiátrico do estado de Nova York. E ele já vai receber a credencial dele como profissional da área que vai trabalhar e tratar de pessoas com dependência química. Yes, Nicholas, I was saying a little bit what you were saying, that we need to, you know, to change the minds. We need to create an awareness, you know. People have to grow conscious about it, what is going on. Because you can't keep doing this. This is a violation that we can change the laws. But for that, people have to... This is a national problem. Because this violation that is happening, it's not only one state.
No, of course.
It happens nationally. And the issue is that there are social movements that is happening, but to crush these social movements, last week it was passed a law that according to what it says, it says that this law allowed the government to kill leaders from the social movements. Like any leader that is fighting for social justice in Brazil, they pass a law that will authorize a force directed by the government to kill leaders from the social movements. So right there, that is a violation of human rights.
Of course,
So the idea that we have this podcast is to educate more people, only in Brazil, but also here, because we have a different reality. We have our own issues in America, but with people with respect and dignity, and we respect their will. We don't enforce how you and other people.
Yeah.
Right. So that's what is great about America.
Yeah, and I mean, it's tragic to hear that, that Brazil is passing such like authoritarian laws. So maybe, you know, even if maybe laws can't be changed now, people who are listening to this right now, one thing they can do, if you live with a mental health disorder or you've ever struggled with substance use, if you can share that story with other people, if you found recovery on your own, you know, just spreading awareness that recovery is possible, even if it's just to the people around you. It doesn't even need to be a big, you know, it doesn't have to be on a public medium like this. Because I think a lot of the biggest changes in the world start with changing the communities you live in. It's about, you know, it changing the minds of your family members, your neighbors, encouraging them to open their hearts to other people. And a lot of times, if you can share personal experience, or if you know someone that, you know, you can safely disclose that they've struggled with this kind of thing, and yet they've succeeded, that maybe by changing the hearts of the masses, that'll help lead to change where we can change it from on the government level.
But you know, Nick, what happened to my nephew, José Bandeiros Silvina de Souza, Vavá, is that certain part of the country, certain states, they still very close mind.
Yeah.
And
true.
even the community, they you are, if you have a behavioral mental health, you are stigmatized, you are discriminated, and they confuse you. It because they don't understand, they don't know what they are talking about.
Yeah.
They have no knowledge, so they treat you as a person either as a criminal, or they treat you as a person who is a drug addict.
Yeah.
That's what happened to the 17 years old boy Vavá. Yeah. They did not understand because he was hyperactivity, you know, hyper like he was. His condition, he has schizophrenia and other diagnoses.
Yeah.
But one of his symptoms, when he's without medication, he gets very agitated. He can't sit still.
Yeah.
And according to those people down there, he, for them, he was a drug addict.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why they did not help him.
Yeah.
But then later on, they can, you know, I guess, there are rumors, the same people came and snatched him, and nowadays we don't know what happened to him.
Yeah.
So you're right. So Nicolas está dizendo que a sua própria comunidade, se você começa a criar, né, a educar as pessoas na sua comunidade sobre as doenças, sobre a deficiência, né, de transtornos mentais, de saúde mental, de dependência química, então aquilo já vai educando as pessoas. Que você pode não conhecer, nunca viu, mas quando você começa a falar sobre o assunto, então vai, as pessoas vão começando a aceitar, a ver, né, que a pessoa com doença mental é só um ser humano e que não é culpa daquela pessoa ter, né, sofrer dessa condição. Uma pessoa que sofre de transtorno de saúde mental não deve ser punida, não deve ser discriminada por ela ter essa condição, porque ela não pediu para ter esta condição, ela não pediu para ser assim. E qualquer pessoa pode, da noite para o dia, desenvolver um problema de saúde mental. Como eu tenho um doutor Richard, ele sempre me fala que a mente humana é uma coisa muito sensível. Hoje você está bom, mas da noite para o dia, uma coisa acontece na sua vida, você totalmente perde o controle da sua mente. Então, eu quero deixar bem claro que ninguém escolhe ser deficiente, ninguém escolhe ter esquizofrenia, ninguém escolhe ter uma doença que não tem controle, ninguém escolhe ser doente, ter uma adição química. Então, está na hora de nós começarmos a educarmos a nossa comunidade, a educarmos os nossos parentes, os nossos vizinhos, todas as pessoas, né, nossos amigos, a sociedade, os profissionais, os políticos, que ninguém escolhe ser deficiente, de saúde mental. É uma doença que a doença por si própria já pune uma pessoa que não merece. Então, por que é que a sociedade quer punir as pessoas que têm, que sofrem destes problemas de saúde? Não está certo. Isso está errado. Isso é uma violação de direitos humanos. É violações das leis domésticas que o país, o Estado, o Estado tem responsabilidade de proteger estas pessoas vulneráveis e não está protegendo. Está permitindo que elas sejam massacradas. I was saying that, you know, that you explained that to educate our neighbors, to, you know, to talk, to educate the community. And mm-hmm. I always explain, you know, how it's hard because the lack of knowledge, some people, they don't understand what is really going on.
No.
But like a little by little, we can take this step and start educating. Yeah. Like what we're doing here. We have this conversation here. It's so good right now.
Absolutely.
You feel so comfortable.
mm-hmm.
You are feeling so comfortable that like we're talking in the office, you know, mm-hmm. you're giving a little bit of a share. So, Nick, if we were to do like some a training online, how would we do it? No, like let's say in the near future, if we want to design a training to, you know, to help our folks down there in Brazil, how would we do that?
I think what I would suggest as far as, you know, having me or someone else potentially make maybe a little course that we could do online over an online platform. We can kind of demonstrate, you know, the model that we use, how we help people. And then maybe that'll inspire people in Brazil to figure out something that works well for them. See, like, take what works from what we have. And, you know, if they need to change things here and there, and then find what would work best for the people of Brazil to help support them in what they could do.
So it would be, who would we first, you know, offer this course? You think who would we offer first? Would it be the people who work in the area of the mental health? Or would it be just common folks like people who are in recovery or people who recover from, and so who would be like you with your experience with all your training in the mm-hmm. dependence treatment and substance misuse, who would be like the target population for you?
I think ideally you would have two separate courses. You would do one for people who are actually in the field helping to treat people who could try to implement better ways of supporting them. But also we could do a course with people in the general population on how to, you know, if you're living with someone who has one of these conditions, or if you are someone who has one of these conditions, you know, finding your own avenues of support for people in your community or for yourself or for a loved one. So I think ideally you'd have two different courses, one for clinicians and one for people in the community that are interested about learning more.
So you say that it would be two different courses, one for the community and one for the clinicians?
I mean, I feel like that would be the ideal. I mean, depending on time and available resources, what we may just need to combine the, you know, all of that into one. But, you know, in a perfect world, I think having two courses would be great because I think everyone can learn about this and find ways of supporting people in their community or loved ones or even themselves. It can't all just fall to clinicians to do everything.
Oh, all right. So, Nicolas, eu perguntei para Nicolas se fôssemos oferecer treinamento para ajudar pessoas no Brasil, como o tratamento de pessoas com história de dependência química. Ele está falando que o ideal seria treinamento para profissionais da área de saúde, né, que trabalham com a população, e outro, e treinar a comunidade, né, parentes, familiares, né, de pessoas que têm, que tá em tratamento de dependência química ou que está ou que precisa, né, treinar essa comunidade de familiares, de parentes, de amigos, para saber, conhecer mais sobre o assunto. E ele está falando que o ideal é fazer dois diferentes treinamentos, né? A gente não pode esperar que só que só os profissionais da saúde ajude essa população. É também a nossa responsabilidade de nos educar, de buscarmos o conhecimento para poder, especialmente familiares de pessoas que têm, como a minha família mesmo, não sabia nada sobre pessoas que sofrem de doença mental, como o Vavá, pessoas que sofrem de esquizofrenia, o Vavá sofre de esquizofrenia, sofre de deficiência intelectual, ele sofre de uma outra condição que é parecido com o autismo. Então, ele tem três diferentes diagnoses que ele sofre. Então, só uma pessoa ignorante, sem conhecimento como as pessoas do Conselho Tutelar do Alto Alegre do Maranhão, foi que disseram que ele era um viciado, né? Então, pessoas sem conhecimento que tiram essas conclusões por eles mesmos. Então, Nick, like I was explained that you say that the training, you know, it should ideally would be training the health professionals and training the family, mm-hmm. the community, so they could know what, you know, learn more how to deal with the situation, mm-hmm. learn more how to live with and how to prevent. So that it would be like an amazing thing. So yeah. I asked, you don't know Max Gutman, but I will introduce you to him. Mm-hmm. One of these days, I'm going to make mm-hmm. a live that we can come together and talk about it. So mm-hmm. we're going to talk a lot of things. Max, he's a social worker, mm-hmm. and he has been working in this field for very long. Mm-hmm. You know, he also works as a clinician, you know. And I asked him about it, you know, that we could put a behavioral mental health training. They were like, the peer movement kind, you know, that we could educate in the community. Mm-hmm. And he said, yeah, no, I can design the part that is behavioral mental health, but I don't know about the substance misuse sure. treatment. So I told him, oh, I know someone, mm-hmm. you know, I know someone who will help me. By that time, we already had talked about that we would work and do something.
Yeah.
I know that we all have been so busy and you know, you have all your stuff and I have my, but to some point, I think we're going to start put something together so that we can start it. And I think it is a great idea that we can do an online training.
Yeah.
Right. I can translate everything to Portuguese. Of course, all the credits is going to go to you.
Yeah. Well, I mean, also, I feel like, for those of us in America who are very privileged to live in a society where we're not persecuted for mm-hmm. for having a mental health diagnosis or for substance use, I feel like at least for some of us, there's a responsibility to help people other places that are struggling. Because I mean, we're part of ideally, we should be part of a global community. It's not just, hey, everything's fine here, so, you know, but sorry, you're country's burning down. I wish I could help, but sorry.
It's not my problem.
Yeah, right? but that's how we got into this trouble, is by saying it's not my problem. But no, I mean, that if you're going to be compassionate towards other people, you know, sympathy is feeling bad for someone. Compassion is wanting to help them and then actually doing something about it. And so, you know, I feel like there's a responsibility to help people that need this support.
Yeah, because they're vulnerable. So you still want to be like in the global scale? Because I haven't given up.
Well, yeah, I mean, let's start with Brazil and we'll work global later. Yeah, let's take it one step at a time. One metaphor I like to use with people to help them, especially with people with anxiety, but also when it comes to something as challenging as trying to give up substances, is the question, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. You know, it's this impossible thing, but you do it one little step at a time and you can accomplish anything.
Just it's going to take years.
Little step. It could. Years. It could. Yeah. But it'll be worth it if we can make people's lives better.
Actually, it's already. So we're gonna end soon. But,
okay.
But, you know, so Nicholas está falando que geralmente ele pergunta quando... Tá, né? Para pessoas quando está fazendo tratamento disso, de dependência química, como é que você come um elefante, né? E ele está falando que é pequenas mordidinhas, né? Aos poucos, né? Então, é assim é o tratamento de pessoas com deficiência de saúde mental, assim é o tratamento de pessoas com dependência química, né? Que é um processo lento, é um processo demorado, né? mas que precisa de todo um apoio. Ele também está dizendo que as pessoas aqui, né, não sofrem perseguição como sofrem no Brasil, né? Que são perseguidos, que são discriminados, que realmente que é perigoso ser uma pessoa que sofre, ser uma pessoa pobre, negra e deficiente, como o Vavá, meu sobrinho, é, ser um brasileiro, porque é tratado como marginal, é tratado como vagabundo. Olha aí o que fizeram com o Francisco Osvaldo, o irmão da Cidinha, né? O homem entrou saudável dentro da clínica, fisicamente saudável, e saiu de lá em estado deplorável. Francisco Osvaldo sofreu horrores dentro de uma clínica, segundo seus familiares, e as fotos mostram isso. Ele tinha marcas nos braços, né? todo cheio de marca, perdeu muito peso, estava magro, abatido, fraco, e não resistiu. 3 dias depois que entregaram para a família, faleceu. Olha o caso do Vitor Salles, olha o caso do Xandango, Alexandre, que faleceu dentro de uma clínica no Ceará. Olha o caso da semana passada de um rapaz que foi abusado sexualmente, que eu não me deram o nome, mas que foi abusado sexualmente e depois mataram ele dentro da clínica. Olha o outro caso de um rapaz, de um outro. Então, tem muitas pessoas de diferentes estados que têm perdido a vida dentro dessas instituições, né? Então, é uma perseguição, e o Nicolas está falando que aqui nós não somos perseguidos, nós não somos criminalizados e nem somos punidos por sofrer de uma deficiência de saúde mental, de transtornos, não somos criminalizados e não somos punidos por ter problemas com dependência química, que está errado punir uma pessoa por sofrer de deficiência química e punir uma pessoa por ter problemas de saúde mental. Isso está errado, isso são violações de direitos humanos, são violações da dignidade humana, né? E é isso que ele está falando, que esse é um problema global. Esse tem que ser um problema para todos nós. Tem que ser feito, temos que criar, né, educar, porque não é um problema só do Brasil, é um problema para todos, porque estão violando os direitos das pessoas vulneráveis. E as pessoas vulneráveis é responsabilidade do Estado, das leis do Estado e das leis internacionais, proteger a vida humana, a dignidade humana. E ele está falando que esse assunto, né, do Brasil é realmente tenebroso, né? Que as pessoas são perseguidas por serem doentes, são sequestradas, como o doutor Igor foi sequestrado e jogado dentro de uma solitária. E aqui, isso não se, não, aqui as pessoas, quando a gente fala nisso, as pessoas não acreditam, né? Acham que é uma brincadeira. Pois, Nicolas, I was saying that, you know, what you were saying, that how you eat an elephant, you know, mm-hmm. I was saying that little by little, no? Little, like, yep. Small bites, you know, mm-hmm. and how you do the treatment. And I was mm-hmm. also saying that here in America, we are not prosecuted for being a person yep. with behavioral mental health. We are not prosecuted for having a history of chemical dependency. So I was explaining this, and I was saying that these are gross violations of human rights, and that's yep. not right. You know, and I mentioned some of the victims, the people who actually lost their lives, yeah. Yeah, as a result of this ill treatment inside of the institution. You know, like you read the Francisco Osvaldo's case, mm-hmm. you read Vitor Salles case,
yeah.
You read Vava's case. They read the case about the 33 women that it was mm-hmm. they were in cage, but one of these cases, like Vitor Salles, that they even stole the body and nobody knows where it is.
Yeah.
And the family still wanna, the family actually wanna have the body back.
Of course.
But it's been yeah. 5 years and nobody yeah. knows what happened.
Yeah.
But anyways, so I wanna thank you for coming.
This is a pleasure. Yeah.
And I hope we can have more like good times like this.
Yeah.
And I wanna bring you, and I think you and Max are gonna be great.
Yeah, absolutely. I look forward to it.
So I wanna thank the OBGH for this space. I wanna also apologize for the technical issues. Obrigada, Observatório Brasileiro de Direitos Humanos. no Brasil. Obrigado por este espaço, o Dr. Marcelo, esse grande ser humano e humanitário. Obrigada aos seus colegas por fazer este trabalho possível. Obrigada, Brasil, por o seu tempo. Obrigada. Thank you, American. Thank you. Thank you, Nick, for coming. And hopefully in the near future, we can work together.
Yeah, absolutely.
And we can put together this idea of the course and we can see how that would work. How about that?
Sounds good.
So welcome board then to, let's focus on Brazil now, and then we can think about other countries, right?
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Good night, American. Good Boa night, noite, Brasil. Brasil.